Tonight, we are going to finish the book of Acts. I do feel that truth in advertising requires that I make this statement. Tonight's class is going to be different than what I had planned. And the reason is, this morning as I was walking in, I really sensed the Holy Spirit saying, check out all three of them. It's in every one of them. And I knew immediately what that meant and was kind of taken aback. Got here into the office, looked in my Bible, and sure enough, it was in every one of them. And as a result, I really believe when God intervenes in those ways, it's for a purpose. And so that's the way we're going to proceed here this evening. And if you're wondering, well, what in the world does that mean? Hang on, you'll find out in just a little while, okay? So let's begin with a word of prayer, and then we will finish up our study of the book of Acts. Heavenly Father, it is so good to be in your presence here together tonight. We thank you that you are our God. We thank you that you are near to us. We thank you that your heart has always been for your children, and you desire all to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. We thank you, Lord, that you speak to us through your word. You engage not just our minds, but our hearts and our souls. We thank you for our Lord Jesus, for his sacrifice for us, his blood that covers our sins. We thank you for his resurrection from the grave and for his imminent return. We praise you for the Holy Spirit's work among us. We thank you that the Holy Spirit not only leads us to you and enables us to believe, but we thank you that the Spirit of holiness is at work in every one of us who believe to change, to transform, and to renew us. We pray this evening that you would open our minds to understand your word, that you would open our souls and our spirits to receive that word and to put it into practice. And we ask that this evening, as we take a look at the rest of the book of Acts, you would move in a powerful way designed for each one of us to confirm, to confront, to console, to comfort, to challenge, and to convict. Whatever we need, Lord, we pray that you would provide it. And we ask this in the strong name of Jesus, in all confidence in him. Amen. Well, I'd like to pick up where we had left off last time. And if you will recall in last week's session, as we were talking about the opening chapters of the book of Acts, we had ended with the conversion of this young rabbi, Rabbi Shaul, known as Saul in English, the individual whom we now refer to as the Apostle Paul, and had talked the way God had intervened in his life, turning him from not just an opponent of Christianity, but really changing him from a terrorist into a missionary. Dramatic things that happened, and it's there that we pick up this evening. Saul was most likely in his late 20s or early 30s when he encountered Jesus on the Damascus Road. As you read the book of Acts, it appears that almost immediately after, he became this great missionary who went throughout the Mediterranean world. In reality, as we try to put together the chronology of the book of Acts, it appears that there are a number of silent years in Saul or Paul's life. And we know bits and pieces from the book of Acts, but also from Paul's writings. We know from the book of Galatians, for instance, that the Apostle Paul said after his conversion, he actually went to Arabia and was there for 3 years. It's fascinating. Paul mentions Arabia only in the book of Galatians, but he mentions it in two ways. He says that he went to Arabia. He also uses the analogy of Sarah and Hagar and God's moving by the Spirit or by works of the law. And he mentions the fact that Mount Sinai is in Arabia. I believe that gives us some clue as to what went on in Saul's life during the silent years. This is purely personal speculation, but I believe it is informed and spiritual speculation, okay, that is grounded in Scripture at least. One of the things that we know is that for devout Jewish people, Mount Sinai held a special place. It was where God revealed his holiness, where God told the Israelites he had taken them out of bondage in Egypt, where he equipped them for service to him, where he called them to follow him, where he gave his law, where he gave the tabernacle and the dimensions of the tabernacle and how they were to worship him. This was a fundamental location. Moses encountered God for the first time at Mount Sinai or Mount Horeb. God told Moses that the way Moses could know that God was keeping his plan is that Moses would ultimately lead the Israelites in the not too distant future back to Mount Sinai to worship the Lord. When the great prophet Elijah encountered the most difficult times of his life, where did he flee? He fled to Mount Sinai. I believe that the Apostle Paul may well have gone to Mount Sinai in Arabia during that period that covered 3 years, as he too wrestled with the way God had revealed himself. If you think about it, he experienced something akin to what Moses experienced. All of a sudden, a dramatic encounter with the living God that just absolutely changed his life. He experienced something akin to what the great prophet Elijah experienced when the Lord ministered to Elijah as he was ready just to give up and say, "That's it, I'm no better than any of my ancestors." You know, and the Lord speaks to Elijah powerfully at Mount Sinai. Just looking at what Paul went through and looking at what he mentions here in Galatians suggests to me at least the very real possibility that that's where he went, perhaps even to the cave where Moses had gone and where Elijah had gone, as he grappled with what the scriptures say, what God had revealed to him on the road at Damascus that absolutely turned his world upside down. It would make perfect sense for a devout Jew. It also fits, I believe, what we see, the little bits and pieces that we see in the scriptures. We also know that after that time in Arabia, Paul goes back to Damascus, and we're told in 2 Corinthians chapter 11 that he actually during the reign of King Aretas, who ruled out of Petra, Paul was spirited out of the city of Damascus, lowered through the wall in a basket so that those who wanted to kill him because of his witness to Jesus couldn't get to him. We also know that in addition to that, Saul then went to Jerusalem for a couple of weeks, that he spent time with some of the leaders there, with Peter, and then was again whisked out of the city and went back to his home in Cilicia, the home where he had grown up as a little boy in Tarsus. And then we hear very little about him for an extended period of time. In fact, there may well be a period of about 10 years from the time of his conversion until the time he begins his missionary service, as we read it in the book of Acts. And so it's important to keep that in mind as we're looking at this. Basically then, what we see in Acts are the final two decades of his life and of his work and ministry in Jesus' name. And so on that note, I'd like to turn to Acts chapter 11 and pick up with the storyline. This is what we read in Acts 11. I'm going to start at verse 19, and this is what we read. It says, "Now those who had been scattered by the persecution that broke out when Stephen was killed traveled as far as Phoenicia, Cyprus, and Antioch, spreading the word only among Jews. Some of them, however, men from Cyprus and Cyrene, went to Antioch and began to speak to Greeks also, telling them the good news about the Lord Jesus. The Lord's hand was with them, and a great number of people believed and turned to the Lord. News of this reached the church in Jerusalem, and they sent Barnabas to Antioch. When he arrived and saw what the grace of God had done, he was glad and encouraged them all to remain true to the Lord with all their hearts. He was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and faith, and a great number of people were brought to the Lord. Then Barnabas went to Tarsus to look for Saul. And when he found him, he brought him to Antioch. So for a whole year, Barnabas and Saul met with the church and taught great numbers of people. The disciples were called Christians first at Antioch." And that is the way Luke introduces the church in the city that will become the center of the Christian missionary movement. Although the message was first proclaimed in Jerusalem and then in Judea and Samaria, now in Antioch, incredible things begin to happen. Antioch is located near the coast of the Mediterranean. It is referred to in biblical terms as Antioch in Syria. By the way, there are a number of Antiochs. We're going to see two of them tonight. But Antioch was originally established by one of Alexander the Great's generals, a general by the name of Seleucus. And as best we can tell, he actually named the city after his son. He named a number of cities after his son, I might add. In fact, you will find Antiochs all over the ancient Mediterranean, the Eastern Mediterranean. Some counts raise it as high as about 16 different Antiochs. So Antiochs are like Marys in the scripture. They keep showing up over and again. The Antioch we're going to especially concentrate on tonight is Antioch in Syria. And to help you keep that in mind, Antioch in Syria is today in Turkey. That really helped, didn't it? Yeah. And by the way, the other Antioch that we're going to read about is also in Turkey. So it really gets confusing. But the Antioch near the coast of the Mediterranean, the eastern coast of the Mediterranean, was the third largest city in the ancient Roman Empire. Rome was the largest. Second city in population, we believe, was Alexandria in Egypt, and it's out of Alexandria that the grain ships that kept Rome supplied with food, that's where they were based. Alexandria was a great center of learning. The greatest library in the ancient world was located in Alexandria, and a huge Jewish community in Alexandria. Two of the five major districts of the city were primarily Jewish. It is there, according to very early Christian traditions, that John Mark, the author of the Gospel of Mark, established a church in Alexandria that spread throughout Egypt. Antioch in Syria was the third largest city in the empire, and it had a great deal in common with 21st century America. Here's why. First of all, it was a city that was made up of people from all different backgrounds, nationalities, and languages. The world had settled in Antioch. Secondly, it was very wealthy. Thirdly, it was noted for its entertainment industry. Does that sound familiar? On top of that, it was noted for spreading all sorts of garbage throughout the ancient world. The Romans, who were certainly not paragons of virtue, talked about Antioch as the place where all the crazies came from. In fact, there was a phrase that was widely used among the Romans that goes like this. It says that all of the garbage from the Orontes ends up in the Tiber. And what that's saying, the Orontes River flowed through Antioch. The Tiber, of course, flows through Rome. And in effect, what they were saying is all the crazy stuff out of California ends up here in the capital city, you know. And Antioch was looked upon as being a place of just, you know, moral decay. And for the Romans to talk about moral decay, I mean, that's, you know, you got to be pretty low on the totem pole. But it's there in Antioch, in this wealthy, multicultural, incredibly arts-oriented, entertainment-oriented community, that the gospel of Jesus takes root and explodes. And the believers who had been scattered by the persecution that Saul himself had in effect started, they end up, many of them, going to Antioch, and instead of just talking to Jews, they talk to non-Jews, to Gentiles, and many of these people believe. And so Barnabas is sent up there by the apostles down in Jerusalem to check things out. Barnabas gets up there, and Barnabas, of course, is the man who had first introduced Paul to the apostles and said, this guy's conversion, I believe, is genuine. You need to meet with him. And so he sees what's going on in Antioch, and he thinks, I know exactly the man for the job here. And so he goes off into Cilicia, what we would call today southeastern Turkey, finds Saul around his hometown of Tarsus, brings him back to Antioch, and for the next year, they work in Antioch with these new believers. They ground them in the scriptures. They share the message of Jesus, and they help them to grow as disciples of Christ. And it's there at Antioch that the modern missionary movement truly takes root. And what we see in the rest of the book of Acts is God using believers out of this community to go out into the entire Roman world. And, it is one of the most influential churches in the history of the planet. And it's there that Saul and Barnabas begin working together. And that's where I'd like to pick up now as we take a look at the final chapters of the book of Acts, chapters 13 through 28, and relate the story of how God used the Apostle Paul and others to bring the message of Jesus across the empire all the way to the capital city itself. As we do that, if you turn to chapter 13, beginning at verse 1, it is quite instructive to note how the Lord orchestrates this. This is what we read. It says, chapter 13, verse 1, "Now in the church at Antioch there were prophets and teachers, Barnabas, Simeon called Niger, which means black man, Lucius of Cyrene, Manaen, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch," in other words, with Herod Antipas, "and Saul. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, 'Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them.' So after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off." Please note the missionary strategy of the early believers. It is considerably different from what we often see in mainline Christianity today. The missionary strategy did not go like this: "Let's have a meeting and decide what we're going to do, and then we'll close with prayer and ask God to bless it." Instead, what they did is they fasted, they prayed, they worshiped the Lord, and while they were fasting and praying, the Holy Spirit says, "Here's what I want you to do." God not only is the one who saves us, God not only is the one whose spirit convicts our hearts and our souls, God not only is the one who has redeemed us through the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus, God not only is the one who calls wayward people back to Him, God is not only the one who steps into people's lives who are hostile to Him and turns their lives around, but God is also the one who gives the strategy for His believers to reach the rest of the world. I believe that is something we need to recapture. That is the way the scriptures describe it. That's the way Jesus talked. It's the way the early believers in the book of Acts did things. It's what we see in Paul's missionary letters and what we see in his missionary journeys. It is not something that is simply confined to one particular point in time, and now we're free to do our own thing. The Bible is giving us a clear understanding of how God desires to move. And what it means is we surrender to Him and allow Him to guide and direct us instead of trying to do it in our own power. That sounds far more biblical, doesn't it? Trust in me with all your heart. Do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge me, and I will direct your path. That's kind of a paraphrase of Proverbs 3. That is what the Lord is doing here. And so with that, Barnabas and Saul set off on their first missionary journey. And what I'd like to do tonight is look at the three major journeys that are described in these chapters of the book of Acts. But I'm going to concentrate on three sermons. And this is what I believe the Holy Spirit was prompting this morning. You see, there are three sermons of Paul that we have here. And last week I'd mentioned it briefly. We have three of his sermons, one from the first missionary journey, one from the second missionary journey, and one from the third missionary journey. They are given to totally different people, each one of them. The message in the first journey is a message delivered in a synagogue at Antioch in Pisidia, not the Antioch where Saul and Barnabas had come from, but a different Antioch. And it is a message that is delivered to devout Jews and to Gentiles who believe in the God of the Hebrew Scriptures but have not become full converts. The second sermon we have is given during the second missionary journey, and it is a sermon in Acts chapter 17 that is delivered to a group of pagans in one of the most influential cities in the ancient world, the city of Athens. The people who hear this do not know the Hebrew scriptures. They know next to nothing about the message of the Messiah. And Paul delivers a very powerful message to them. The third sermon we have is given during the third missionary journey, and it is delivered not to a group of devout Jews and Gentile God-fearers, delivered not to a group of pagans, but it's delivered to elders in the Christian church at Ephesus. And so we have three totally different audiences, three unique sermons. It is obvious that the Holy Spirit chose to insert these for a purpose. And what we're going to see tonight is the strategy in them is different in each occasion, but the message is the same, even down to one of the most controversial points. And that is what the Holy Spirit said this morning on the walk. Take a look. You're going to find it in all three of them. I have read the book of Acts. I have no idea how many times. And I have taught it many times and preached on it. And I miss this. And so when I got back into the office this morning and opened up my Bible, and sure enough, there it was in every one of these. I decided to throw out the outline that we were originally going to use, and instead we're gonna let the Holy Spirit guide the way we do this. So on that note, let's go to missionary journey number one. And if you look up here on the map, I hope this is visible to all of you, and I will try to stand off to the side so that wherever you're seated, you can see this. The journey starts up here in Antioch in Syria. And that's where Saul and Barnabas had been working for a period of a year together. And when the Holy Spirit says, set apart Saul and Barnabas for the work that I've given them to do, they send off two of their best pastors to go out and begin spreading the message throughout the Mediterranean world. They set sail for the island of Cyprus. They come to the port of Salamis, or Salamis, depending on how you want to pronounce it. I prefer Salamis. Go down to Paphos, and it's along the way that they meet a Roman official, a governor, an individual, Sergius Paulus is his name, and a very learned man, very influential. And Saul and Barnabas begin sharing the message of Jesus with Sergius Paulus. But Sergius Paulus has a personal theological counselor, a religious guru who has been advising him, a man who is Jewish. And this guy tries to convince Sergius Paulus that these two missionaries are frauds. And at that point, Paul steps in and really takes the lead on the missionary team, and he looks at this religious advisor and says, God is going to strike you blind. Now, we read that and we say, whoa, you know, why would Paul do such a thing? And the answer is he didn't do it in his own mind or out of his own strength or his own thought. He's following God's direction, and for good cause. Because what had Saul experienced in his own life? He was headed off in the wrong direction, opposing the things of God. God intervenes and blinds him for 3 days. And you know, when you can't see, all of a sudden you can see things clearer. You know, you may not be able to see things physically, but spiritually you can see some things. And so what Saul prays for this advisor is the very thing he himself had experienced. And with that, Sergius Paulus, the governor, says, this is the genuine article. This is the real deal here. And is himself converted to follow Jesus as Messiah and Savior. And by the way, from that point on, Saul is no longer called Saul. He's called Paul. And many have speculated it was in honor of Sergius Paulus, this, you know, high Roman official. Most likely, Saul was his Hebrew name, and he would have had a quote-unquote Roman name as well. It was very common in the ancient world. But now that is the name by which he goes as he moves into the non-Jewish world. And so from that point on, we will be referring to him as Paul, just as the book of Acts does. And so they go from Paphos up here into what we would call South Central Turkey. It is there that Paul experiences what he calls in 2 Corinthians 12 a thorn in the flesh. And when he writes months later to the group of churches that he had established in this region called Galatia, he mentions to them, "I first came to you in sickness, and you would have plucked out your eyes for me." Many have suggested that the thorn in the flesh was an eye problem. Whatever the case, it's at this point that John Mark, the cousin of Barnabas, leaves the missionary team, heads back home, and Paul and Barnabas go on with the rest of the journey. They come to a city in the highlands here known as Antioch in Pisidia, and it's there that we hear the first of Paul's sermons in the New Testament. And so if you would turn in your Bibles to the book of Acts, chapter 13, I'd like to pick up at verse 16, and I'm going to read this entire sermon. I will read it quickly. Luke probably does not give us every word that was shared by Paul, but he gives us a very thorough outline and overview of what was said. Take a listen to these words, and let's evaluate them as a result. Now, keep in mind, he is in a synagogue. He is speaking to devout Jews and to Gentiles who are not yet full converts. By the way, in the ancient world, Gentiles who became attached to the synagogue without actually becoming Jewish were referred to as God-fearers. And that is the term that the New Testament often uses of them. God-fearers or fearers of God. Many of them were men. More women, we believe, than men became full converts. And the reason, I think, is very obvious. The reason is simply to become a full convert to Judaism, if you were a man, you had to be circumcised. And there, you know, there were many men in the ancient world who were attracted by the Hebrew scriptures, by belief in a single deity who is the creator of all things. They were attracted by the high moral standards of the Hebrew scriptures. But the idea of getting circumcised when they were in their 30s and 40s and 20s, you know, I need to think about that one a little bit. Now, those are the people that Paul and Barnabas are speaking to. And this is what we read in Acts 13, beginning at verse 16. The leaders of the synagogue had asked them, "If you have a word of exhortation for the people, please speak." Verse 16, "Standing up, Paul motioned with his hand." I think that's a fascinating phrase. And it's a reminder that this is an account put together on the basis of eyewitnesses. It even includes the fact that Paul is motioning with his hand as he speaks these words. He said, "Fellow Israelites and you Gentiles who worship God, listen to me. The God of the people of Israel chose our ancestors. He made the people prosper during their stay in Egypt. With mighty power, he led them out of that country. And for about 40 years, he endured their conduct in the wilderness. And he overthrew the seven nations in Canaan, giving their land to his people as their inheritance. All this took about 450 years. After this, God gave them judges until the time of Samuel the prophet. Then the people asked for a king, and he gave them Saul, son of Kish, of the tribe of Benjamin, who ruled for 40 years. After removing Saul, he made David their king. God testified concerning him, 'I have found David, son of Jesse, a man after my own heart. He will do everything I want him to do. From this man's descendants, God has brought to Israel the Savior Jesus, as he promised. Before the coming of Jesus, John preached repentance and a baptism to all the people of Israel. As John was completing his work, he said, "Who do you suppose I am? I am not the one you're looking for, but there is one coming after me whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. Fellow children of Abraham and you God-fearing Gentiles, it is to us that this message of salvation has been sent. The people of Jerusalem and their rulers did not recognize Jesus, yet in condemning him, they fulfilled the words of the prophets that are read every Sabbath. Though they found no proper ground for a death sentence, they asked Pilate to have him executed. When they had carried out all that was written about him, they took him down from the cross and laid him in a tomb. But God raised him from the dead, and for many days he was seen by those who had traveled with him from Galilee to Jerusalem. They are now his witnesses to our people. We tell you the good news. What God promised our ancestors, he has fulfilled for us, their children, by raising up Jesus. As it is written in the second Psalm, 'You are my son, today I've become your father.' God raised him from the dead so that he would never be subject to decay. As God has said, 'I will give you the holy and sure blessings promised to David.' So it is also stated elsewhere, 'You will not let your Holy One see decay.' Now when David had served God's purpose in his own generation, he fell asleep, he was buried with his ancestors, and his body decayed. But the one whom God raised from the dead did not see decay. Therefore, my friends, I want you to know that through Jesus, the forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you. Through him, everyone who believes is set free from every sin, a justification you were not able to obtain under the law of Moses. Take care that what the prophets have said does not happen to you. Look, you scoffers, wonder and perish, for I'm going to do something in your days that you would never believe even if someone told you." As Paul and Barnabas were leaving the synagogue, the people invited them to speak further about these things on the next Sabbath. Now, that's a pretty extensive outline that Luke gives us there. And it is incredibly significant. Note, he is speaking to devout Jews and to Gentiles who know the Hebrew Scriptures. And so what does he do? He begins where they are, what they know. He begins with what we call the revealed knowledge of God, what God has revealed in the Scriptures, what God has demonstrated in history, the way God has shown himself to his people. And he basically tells the story of the people of Israel from the time they come out of the promised land, and God promises to Abraham and Isaac and Jacob that he will bless them, and through them will come Messiah, through their stay in Egypt, through the dramatic deliverance, coming to the land at the time of the judges, the coming of the first king, Saul, and then of David, who would become the one through whom Messiah's line would be established. And then finally, as Paul puts it, and now at the fulfillment of time, God has brought all this together for us. And everything that you read about on the Sabbath has come to fulfillment in the person of Jesus, who died for us, who is risen from the grave, and he calls all people now to repentance and to faith. And that is the message that he proclaims. Note, he is speaking to religious people. And what does he say? He says, John the Baptist came and preached repentance and baptism. What does the New Testament say? That repentance and forgiveness of sins will be preached in Jesus' name throughout the nations, and then the end will come. And so what does Paul do? He does what the Lord has told us to do. He proclaims repentance and faith. He emphasizes the resurrection of Jesus, the fulfillment of the Hebrew Scriptures. These are people who know the Bible. And he says, now you also need to repent and believe on the Lord. And he pleads with them, don't make the mistake that the prophets warn us about, of turning away from the living God and rejecting what he has done and is doing. And the response of the people is, hey, would you come back next week? We'd like to hear more about this. Great things happen in Antioch and Pisidia for a little while, But as we've already seen in Acts, and as we will continue to see throughout the book of Acts, when God breaks in, the enemy pushes back. And Paul and Barnabas finally have to leave Antioch and Pisidia. And as you read the rest of this first missionary journey that is described in chapters 13 and 14, you find that everywhere they go, God does amazing things, but there is also incredible pushback from the enemy. In fact, at one point, Paul is actually stoned outside the city and left for dead. And he miraculously is spared. He actually, after all of the people who have been stoning him leave, he actually gets up. When he writes to the Galatians months later, he will say, "I bear on my body the marks of Jesus." And he is most likely referring to the stoning that took place during this this first missionary journey. He has the scars to prove it, you know. But that is the message that is proclaimed in this journey. And with that, he continues on to Iconium, to Lystra, to Derbe, right here in the heart of what was commonly referred to as Galatia. Then returns to Antioch, tells the good news there, and then goes down to the city of Jerusalem, where he defends the proclamation of Jesus as Messiah to the Gentiles, and makes sure that what he is saying is in line with apostolic teaching. That is the first missionary journey in these two chapters, 13 and 14, of the book of Acts. And it leads us then to the second journey that follows after the first Christian convention. It took them quite a few years before they had a convention. And even then, it was just to deal with some issues that had arisen, specifically the issues that had been generated by the church at Antioch and by Paul and Barnabas's missionary journey. How do we take in all of these Gentiles who are coming to the faith? Many devout Jewish believers in Jesus were saying they've got to obey the laws of Moses. They've got to obey all of the ritual laws of the Old Testament. They need to eat kosher. They need to be circumcised and so forth. And what wins the day is what the Apostle Peter and James, the half-brother of Jesus, say. You know, we haven't kept the law. And God has said there's a new covenant. And that new covenant is in the Lord Jesus. Therefore, we need to tell these people, we don't want to stand in the way of what God is doing. He's given them the Holy Spirit just as he's given us. And so with that confidence, Paul and Barnabas prepare to leave on a second journey. But in the midst of that, they have a bit of a falling, not a bit of a, they have a real falling out. Because Barnabas wants his cousin, John Mark, to come along. And Paul says, no way. He left us back there when we left Cyprus. He didn't follow with us on the rest of the journey. We're not taking him with us. And the two of them have such a strong disagreement with one another that they resolve to go separate directions. Barnabas goes back to Cyprus, where he and Saul had done their early work. Paul goes on, along with others, to move back into the area of Galatia, to revisit the churches they had established on the first missionary journey, and then they push on. And it's fascinating to read what we're told in the book of Acts in chapters 15 and following. Chapter 15, and we read this, that as they went into the area around Asia, they wanted to go to Asia, they wanted to go up into Bithynia, they wanted to go to Mysia, and on each occasion the Holy Spirit says, no. No, that's not where I want you to go. They are listening to God's guidance and direction. They're not trying to do this in their own strength. And so with that, they go to sleep one night, and after having been told, don't go there, don't go there, don't go there, Paul has a dream and sees a vision, a man from Macedonia, what we would call today Europe, saying, come over and help us. And so when he wakes up that morning, he tells his missionary team, here's what I received overnight, and they say, that's where we're going. And so with that, they leave what we today would call Turkey. They leave the Middle East, and they head into Europe itself, as we would refer to it today. And they go past some pretty historic sites, by the way. They leave the port of Troas, which is very close to the ancient city of Troy. And, you know, if you're into Homer and the Iliad and the Odyssey, Paul and the others are going right by there. And they head into what we today would call Macedonia and Greece, going to Philippi, Amphipolis, Apollonia, Thessalonica, Berea, and in each occasion, God does mighty things, but there is great pushback against the message of Jesus. And so on each occasion, they've got to keep moving on. Paul finally is told by the believers, you got to get out of here because they're going to kill you, and it's not going to be healthy for these new believers. And so they send him down to Athens. And it's there that I'd like to take a look at the second sermon. Now, Athens at this point was really in many ways a shadow of its former self. Athens had been noted in the ancient world as the center of learning. 5th century BC Athens at the time of Pericles was a dynamic and incredible city-state. And at Athens, you had some of the most majestic building in all of the ancient world. It's there now that Paul comes, a city that today astounds people. If you've ever been to Athens or if you've seen pictures of Athens, you know it is an incredible sight. Right now in Greece, they're going through some really, you know, difficult financial times, but the ruins of ancient Athens are amazing to behold. And in Acts chapter 17, we read that the Apostle Paul now comes to Athens, and he is aghast at what he sees. This beautiful city that is filled with pagan temples, with idols, and you know, even today, you go to Athens, and the Parthenon dominates everything. And you look at this great Acropolis with this beautiful temple, the Parthenon, on top of it. And we only see a portion of what once was, because the Parthenon was actually pretty much destroyed in modern times. And it was actually being used as a magazine. And I don't mean what you sell on the newsstand. I mean where you keep explosives. It exploded, and much of the Parthenon was destroyed. We just see the shell. At the time of Paul, in the Parthenon, there was a gigantic statue of the goddess Athena, who was the patron deity of Athens. It was a statue created by the great Greek sculptor Phidias. As best we can tell, it was a statue of Athena that stood somewhere between 35 and 40 feet tall. And it was right there in the center of the Parthenon. On top of that, all through the city, altars, statues, all sorts of deities. And it's on that note now that Paul speaks to these pagan people, these individuals who believe in a variety of false gods, a group of philosophers. Luke describes many of the individuals as being Stoic and Epicurean philosophers. To put it very simply, the Epicurean philosophers believed that the highest goal was pleasure, and not necessarily in the bad sense of the term, but in the sense of truly having a meaningful and enjoyable life. The Stoics, on the other hand, emphasized the importance of bearing up under difficulties and struggles and not giving in to the pressures of life. But Paul comes now, and he's speaking to people who do not know the Scriptures, who have never encountered the law of Moses, who do not know anything about Judaism, and who know next to nothing about the Messiah and the resurrection of Jesus. And it's fascinating to see what he says, how different the strategy is from when he spoke in Antioch with Jews and knowledgeable Gentiles. He comes at it in a different way, but please note, the heart of it remains the same. And so this is what we read. If you turn to Acts chapter 17, Paul in the city of Athens. And I'd like to start, if we could, verse 22. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus. Areopagus, by the way, is just a direct transliteration of the Greek. It literally means Mars Hill. And even today, when you go to Athens, in the shadow of the Acropolis and the Parthenon, is this massive rocky outcropping, Mars Hill. The Areopagus, Mars Hill, became the name of what we would call, you know, one of the primary judicial and executive and legislative branches of ancient Athens. It's where discussions on public policy were made. It's where the movers and the shakers gathered. We don't know for sure where they met in Paul's day. There's some evidence to suggest that they met down in the forum, but the word Areopagus refers to this massive hill, and it may have been there that they met. You know, you can't go wrong in any way. You know, you're close to the scene. And now keep in mind, the Areopagus, Mars Hill, is just to the north and west of the Parthenon. And when you're on Mars Hill, you look directly over at the Parthenon and the Acropolis. And so here is what Paul says as he's speaking to these movers and shakers in the city of Athens, people who do not know the scriptures. He says, verse 22, Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, "People of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.' So you are ignorant of the very thing you worship, and this is what I'm going to proclaim to you." You know, it is very skillful, isn't it? He's acknowledging what he sees all around. And as he's speaking, I mean, there are temples and statues everywhere. He says, "I want to talk to you about the unknown God." Now, how is he approaching them? When he spoke to people in Antioch and Pisidia who knew the scriptures, he spoke on the basis of the revealed knowledge of God, what God shows us in his word, what he has demonstrated in the Hebrew scriptures. Now that he's talking to people who know nothing about the scriptures, where does he start? He starts with the natural knowledge of God. And you know, the New Testament, Paul in to the Romans, for instance, emphasizes the fact that all people, Jew and Gentile alike, can know that there is a God simply on the basis of what he has revealed in nature. That's the natural knowledge of God. What you sense in your conscience, what you can see in the heavens and see in the world around us, this couldn't be an accident. This did not happen by chance. There is a creator. And it's on that basis that Paul speaks to them. It is brilliant missionary strategy. It really is. But please note that he takes them then to the heart of the gospel message. And so this is what we read. Paul goes on and says, verse 24, "The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth and does not live in temples built by human hands." And boy, those words must have really spoken. You know, as you're looking at one of the most beautiful temples ever made with one of the greatest statues ever constructed by a human being. Paul says, "The Most High does not live in temples built by human hands." Whoa, you know, he's got their attention now. And he goes on and he says, "And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. From one man he made all the nations that they should inhabit the whole earth, and he marked out their appointed times in history and the boundaries of their lands." In other words, God has decreed where different groups of people will live, what nations will rise and fall. God is the one who is truly the God of the nations and of all the earth. God did this, verse 27, so that they would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from any of us. And now he quotes one of their philosophers, Epimenides, and he says, "For in him we live and move and have our being." Paul was a well-educated man. And he is at home among the scholars and the philosophers. And so he is coming at them with what they already know. And he's stressing this natural knowledge of God. Even your own philosophers admitted that in him we live and move and have our being. And then he goes on and he says, "As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring." And here he's quoting a Stoic philosopher by the name of Aratus. We are his offspring. And then he says, "Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by human design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent." And note, when he speaks to devout Jews, he says, you need to repent. When he speaks to pagan philosophers, he says, you need to repent. Because that is the message, not just of John the Baptist, not simply of the prophets. That's the message of Jesus. How did Jesus teach? He said, repent, because the kingdom of God has arrived. And so Paul is following the outline that the Lord has given. And he speaks to these pagan philosophers and says, you guys know in your heart, your conscience bears witness. There is a God. There is a creator. And now he is calling all people everywhere to repent. And with that, he goes into the message of the gospel. He says, for he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead. And so he comes right away. And keep in mind, Luke is not giving us every word that Paul spoke. He's giving us an outline after emphasizing the natural knowledge of God that says all people are in need of a Savior. He now says the Savior's come. And he has died and he has risen from the grave. And with that, they begin discussing amongst themselves. And, oh, that's really interesting. And some are attracted to it, others are not. But what we have here is Paul speaking to a unique group in a unique way, but ultimately coming down to the heart of the message, repent and believe the good news. Just as he speaks to the Jews, he also now speaks to Gentile philosophers. And with that, he then continues on his missionary journey, ends up, not a whole lot happened in Athens. But he goes to Corinth, one of the most corrupt cities in the ancient world, spends 18 months there, and God does remarkable things in that city. Having spent time in Corinth, he then sets sail across what we today would call the Aegean, goes over to Ephesus, lets them know that he'll be coming back, he wants to share with them, and then heads off back down to Jerusalem, where he reports to the church, and then goes back to Antioch. And it's from Antioch then that the third missionary journey itself begins. And here, by the way, these maps are maps that we are using by permission. We thank the people who've made them available to us. But I have altered this one. And you notice I put a question mark here and a dotted line. The individuals who drew this map hold to what is sometimes referred to as the Northern Galatian theory. I happen to believe the Southern Galatian theory fits better with the scriptural evidence. And also in light of the fact that we know Paul always kept going back to the churches he had established, it makes better sense in a missiological standpoint. So however he went, I think he probably went back into what we would call southern Galatia, to the cities where he had established churches in the first journey and had visited in the second. And then goes from there over to Ephesus, where he spends 3 years. And in Ephesus, the Lord does incredible things. It turns Ephesus around. Tremendous numbers in Ephesus and Asia, the place where the Holy Spirit had said, don't go here now during the second journey. The third journey, the Holy Spirit's saying, now's the time. This is the ideal moment. And amazing things take place there. And it's in Ephesus, by the way, that we have more ruins, more Roman ruins than we have in Rome itself. Remarkably well preserved. Even the theater where the opponents of the missionaries gathered thousands of people and started chanting, great is Artemis of the Ephesians. By the way, Artemis is the Greek name for Diana, the patron goddess of Athens. She was also the patron goddess of Ephesus. And, they're shouting for hours, great is Artemis of the Ephesians. And Acts tells us many of them didn't even know why they were there. But it shows how the message of Jesus had just totally upset this community. From there, Paul goes on, after spending more time in Ephesus than in any other city recorded in Acts. He goes back, retraces his steps through Greece and Macedonia, and finally comes back heading for Jerusalem, stops in the city of Miletus, and it's here that we have the third sermon recorded in his missionary journeys. And this sermon is a sermon delivered in Acts chapter 20 to a group of church leaders. So these are Christian people. These are people who know Jesus is the Savior. He is the Messiah. He died for us. He is risen from the grave. And Paul speaks to them very personally. And please note the difference in his approach, but the fact that the message, the heart of the message is the same, even speaking to Christian people. Now, Acts chapter 20 is a chapter that is, I'll just say, very near and dear to my heart. In fact, I have been carrying one verse from Acts chapter 20 with me for the last 42 plus years. When Jan and I got engaged and we splurged on our wedding bands. By the way, this is an indication of how gold has changed in value in the last 40 some odd years. We paid a whopping $45 for Jan's wedding band, and since mine was larger, it cost $55. But inside those bands, we had engraved our favorite Bible passages. Jan's is Romans 8, verse 1. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. It's a wonderful verse. Inside mine is a verse from Acts 20. It's Acts 20, verse 24. I still remember reading it in Greek as an 18-year-old in college. And it grabbed me. And it goes like this. I do not consider my life to be of any value, nor as precious to myself, if only I may finish the course and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given to me, the task of testifying to the gospel of God's grace. And that is part of the sermon that Paul delivered to these elders from the church at Ephesus. Let's look at the sermon. If you turn to Acts chapter 20, we read these words. He's gathered them together in this port city of Miletus. By the way, Miletus today is inland. And you say, well, how could it be a port city? The answer is there was a huge earthquake, massive changes in the landscape, and a great deal of silting over the centuries. As a result, when you stand in Miletus today, you say, where in the world did they put the ships? You know, but in reality, in Paul's day, it was a great harbor. And it's there that he meets with these leaders, and this is what we read. Acts chapter 20. Verse 18, when they arrived, he said to them, you know how I lived the whole time I was with you, meaning in Ephesus. From the first day I came into the province of Asia, I served the Lord with great humility and with tears, and in the midst of severe testing by the plots of my Jewish opponents. You know that I have not hesitated to preach anything that would be helpful to you, but have taught you publicly and from house to house. I have declared to both Jews and Greeks that they must turn to God in repentance and have faith in our Lord Jesus. And you notice this emphasis on what Jesus said, on what the New Testament scriptures declare. Repentance and forgiveness of sins will be proclaimed in his name. And Paul says, you guys, you're devout believers, you know that's what I taught, and that is what we all need to hear, repentance and forgiveness of sins in Jesus' name. And so he goes on, and now, compelled by the Spirit, I'm going to Jerusalem, not knowing what will happen to me there. I only know that in every city, the Holy Spirit warns me that prison and hardships are facing me. However, I consider my life worth nothing to me. My only aim is to finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me, the task of testifying to the good news of God's grace. Now I know that none of you among whom I have gone about preaching the kingdom will ever see me again. Therefore, I declare to you today that I'm innocent of the blood of any of you, for I've not hesitated to proclaim to you the whole will of God. Keep watch over yourselves and all the flock of which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. Be shepherds of the church of God, which he bought with his own blood. Don't you love that verse? Be shepherds of the church of God, which he bought with his own blood. Whose blood is that? It's Jesus' blood. Who is Jesus? He is the living God in human flesh, you know? And Paul just makes that so evident. And he says, I know that after I leave, savage wolves will come in among you and will not spare the flock. Even from your own number, men will arise and distort the truth in order to draw away disciples after them. So be on your guard. Remember that for 3 years, I never stopped warning each of you night and day with tears. Now I commit you to God and to the word of his grace, which can build you up and give you an inheritance among all those who are sanctified. I've not coveted anyone's silver or gold or clothing. You yourselves know these hands of mine have supplied my own needs and the needs of my companions. In everything I did, I showed you that by this kind of hard work, we must help the weak, remembering the words of the Lord Jesus himself said, though it is more blessed to give than to receive. When Paul had finished speaking, he knelt down with all of them and prayed. They all wept as they embraced him and kissed him. What grieved them most was his statement they would never see his face again. Then they accompanied him to the ship. Now, that is the message he speaks to leaders. Please note, very different from the other messages. It is especially intended for devout followers of the Lord Jesus Christ. He warns them. What is true throughout the book of Acts is true for them. What we see in all the scriptures, what Paul will tell Timothy, anyone who desires to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Paul is saying to them, you guys are also going to face opposition because the enemy is going to keep pushing back. He's been pushing back for the 3 years I was with you in Ephesus. He is not going to relent. And that pushback is going to come in two ways. Says the pushback is first going to come from the outside world that rejects the message of Jesus. And certainly in Ephesus, we see that in Acts chapter 19, pushback from the silversmiths and others who are saying, these guys they're destroying our business and they're basically trashing our great goddess Diana or Artemis. The pushback will come from the outside world, but it's also going to come from within the church. Even from your own number, Paul says, there will be great pushback. And historically, throughout the last 2,000 years, we have seen that opposition comes from the unbelieving world, but some of the most painful and tragic opposition comes actually from within the church, and that's what Paul is warning them. But you notice also, he brings them the heart of the message. And what we see in Acts 13, what we see in Acts 17 is also at the heart of Acts 20. And what is at the heart of it is this. You need to repent. You need to realize that God has intervened in history, that the Son of God shed his blood for us, that he has risen from the grave, that he is coming back, and he is calling all people to himself. No matter if we are speaking to religious people, devout followers of the Lord, to pagan philosophers, or to individuals who are coming from Jewish background, the message is always the same. Repent and believe the good news. And that is what we see in these three great sermons. And boy, that speaks so much to our day, because one of the things that Western Christianity in general and American Christianity in particular has lost sight of is that heart of the gospel message. And by gospel, I mean the whole gospel. Repent and believe the good news. My personal experience is that it is often the most religious people who react most violently against a message of repentance. Because so much of religion in America today is basically based on the notion that, you know, I'm good, God is nice, and, you know, as long as I have a little bit of Christian seasoning on me, everything is okay. And what the scripture says is, no, that is not biblical faith. And that's why Jesus warns us and says, I tell you, on the last day, many are going to say, Lord, Lord, didn't we do these things in your name and in your name do mighty miracles and so forth? And Jesus says, I never knew you. Because what the Bible is talking about is not, you know, paganism. Pagan religion is basically, I do these things to keep God happy and I have fun doing it. That is not biblical faith. Biblical faith is God does these things to draw me to himself. And the response is that I realize I am a sinner and I need a savior. And as a result, I repent before him and I turn to him and receive forgiveness and life. And more than that, I receive the Holy Spirit who enables me to become the person God always destined me to be. And this is all about having a relationship with the living God. It's not a matter of doing things or going through the motions. It's a matter of knowing the Lord Jesus Christ, knowing the Heavenly Father, experiencing the work of the Holy Spirit in my life. And I mean, that's upsetting in one sense because it means I can't just go along with what's comfortable. But it's joyous in that it delivers us out of bondage into new life. And that is at the heart of what the Apostle Paul proclaimed, and it's at the heart of the book of Acts. But in America today, you know, sadly, much of Christendom is basically all about entertainment. It's about having fun. It's about continuing life in the status quo. And Jesus is not calling us to entertainment. He is not calling us to life in the status quo. He's calling us to himself. And that's why the scriptures place this emphasis on repent and believe the good news. You know, that biblical word for repent is a fascinating word. In the Greek scriptures, the New Testament, the word is metanoia. And it means a change of mind. And that is such a powerful image because it means being changed in our minds. I still remember as a 14-year-old reading the New Testament for myself and coming to Jesus' Sermon on the Mount and reading those words and just being blown away by them. And where they brought me was this. They brought me to the point where I said, man, you know, I may be a good kid, but I have wandered so far away from God's highest standards. I need a savior. You know, I grew up at the height of the Vietnam War when everyone was wearing, you know, long hair and saying, make love, not war, and peace now, and so forth. And I was a pretty straight-laced kid. My hairstyle has not changed in, you know, 50 years here. And, you know, I thought of myself as a good, upstanding kid. And then I read Jesus' words and I think, man, I am a sinner and I need a savior. And that's what the message of Jesus does. It brings us to our knees before him. It is good to be on our knees before God. There's a reason the Bible says repent. Have a change of mind in the way you think about yourself and in the way you think about God. But also in the Hebrew scriptures, the word for repent is a powerful word. Because, you know, the Greek language is very much an intellectual language. It's the language of the philosophers. The Hebrew language of the Old Testament, it is an active language. And the word that is commonly translated repent in the Hebrew scriptures is the Hebrew word shuv. And what it means is to turn around. In other words, to make a 180. Yeah, and because in the Hebrew Bible, the emphasis is always on faith produces results. When God says, hear my voice, it's more than just acknowledging that I've spoken. It's doing what I said. You know, it's the difference between when mom or dad says, would you take out the dog? And the kids say, okay, I understand what that means. And then they go back to watching TV. No, when you understand the truth of what the Lord has said, you take out the dog. You know, and so the Hebrew word for repent means to turn around, to make a 180-degree turn. And that is what the apostle proclaimed, and that's what the book of Acts is talking about. A change of mind, a change of behavior, a change of heart. God touches us and turns us around, and we are now living in a relationship with him. Well, that's pretty much the book of Acts, but just a quick note about the way it ends. It ends with the Apostle Paul, and you'll be able to read this for yourself. The Apostle Paul going back to Jerusalem where he is arrested, spends 2 years in protective custody, finally appeals to the Roman emperor, says, I'm not guilty of the charges they've raised against me. If I've done something deserving death, take my life. But, you know, listen to the facts. And so he goes to Rome. We read about the fascinating voyage. Acts 27 is one of the most remarkable sea voyages in literature. In fact, it is the greatest account of a sea voyage in all of the ancient world. It is written by one who was there. Luke was along for the ride. It ends up with Paul stranded on the island of Malta, a fascinating place, a historic island that has had just, you know, incredible impact in world history. And then he finally ends up going to Rome, where he spends 2 years awaiting trial. And many people say, well, how come it took so long? You know, was the Roman legal system like the American legal system that just drags on for years? And the answer is no. The Roman system was actually, it moved pretty quickly. The problem was Paul, it appears, on the basis of the evidence that we have, he arrived at a particularly difficult time in Roman history. The Emperor Nero, who had started out really well when he followed his tutor Seneca, ended up basically becoming a madman. You know, power corrupts, absolute power corrupts absolutely. And Nero was paranoid. He was especially desirous of getting rid of his mom, who was creating issues for him. And so Nero, at this time, about the very time that Paul is arriving in Malta and heading to Rome, Nero is trying to kill his mom. And he comes up with some rather fascinating ways. I mean, one of the things he has his engineers put together a boat with a trapdoor in it. And he knows mom can't swim. And so he figures, you know, we'll get her out in the we're gonna get her out off the Isle of Capri in the Bay of Naples, and we'll just open up the trap door, and she's gonna drown because she doesn't know how to swim. Well, there's just one problem with it. The engineers who built the boat and put in the trap door hinged it the wrong direction. I mean, somebody was not thinking right, because they hinged it so that the trap door would open downward. And of course, you undo the trap door and water pressure keeps the door shut. You know, they can't get it open. And so the sailors know what they're supposed to do. They're supposed to sink the king's mom, and the trap door isn't working. So they start moving back and forth on the boat from side to side, trying to rock this thing, figuring they'll swamp the boat. They ultimately succeeded, but Nero's mom managed to swim to shore anyway. And so Nero constructed another means of getting rid of her, and it was really quite ingenious. Her bedroom would collapse on her. And, you know, I mean, this sounds like something out of, you know, it is too crazy to not be real, you know. Well, she goes into the bathroom, and so she is spared. And so finally the Marines cut her down. And it's at that point the folks in Rome are furious at Nero. And so he stays on the Isle of Capri. You know, as the song says, 'twas on the Isle of Capri that I found her, not killed her. But anyway, you get the idea. And so during this time, Paul is waiting, and the book of Acts ends with him 2 years in Rome, awaiting trial. And you say, what happened? And if you're still wondering about that, go to our study of Acts number 1 as we discuss some of the possibilities. What we do know from early Christian records and from 2 Timothy, Paul did continue on, apparently got to Spain, and was killed then by Nero a few years later, most likely somewhere between 65 and 67 AD. And that is the book of Acts. Whew. Okay, we're going to close with prayer. Next week, we're going to take a look at the Gospel of John. Fascinating gospel, by the way. And in the last 50 years, huge changes in our understanding of that book. Many individuals for centuries used to say the Gospel of John is the most Greek, the most Gentile of the Gospels. In the last 50 years since the discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls, we now know what ought to have been patently obvious from the beginning. It is the most Jewish of the Gospels. And next week, as we go through John, we're going to take it in a way that you may have never seen before. But once you see it, you will never forget it. It is very, very Jewish. It is a fulfillment of the Hebrew Scriptures in remarkable ways. And it's going to be a fun study. But now we're going to pray. Father, we praise your name. We glorify you. We thank you for the incredible things you've done. We thank you for the way you speak to us in this amazing book. We thank you for the message of salvation that is clearly proclaimed here. We thank you for an outline of how we are to do missionary work, how you have called us to listen to your voice, to follow the Holy Spirit, to go where you lead, and to proclaim repentance and forgiveness of sins in Jesus' name to all who will listen and to any who will hear. We thank you that it is your desire to bring all people to yourself, and therefore we move forward in confidence. And even when the enemy pushes back, we will not be afraid. Instead, we will follow you, we will trust you, and we say, pour out your Spirit upon us, Lord, that we may be equipped to do the work you've given us to do in these last days. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.